Hey everyone, and welcome to CT Tutorials. On this tutorial, what we're going to be focusing on is VR. So what does VR stand for? That is virtual reality. So I've been working a ton in virtual reality the past several months, and I've been using this camera called the Insta360 Pro 2, and with that comes a software called the Insta360 Stitcher. Now, if you're used to it, that's awesome, but if you're just now jumping in, this is kind of a great jumping off point and getting started. So right off the bat, whenever you start out, you're going to have this Insta360 Stitcher GUI home screen pop up. And what you're going to want to do is you're going to want to do a hardware test. That is going to test your performance of your computer. I've already done it, so I'm not going to do it now. So basically what it's going to do is it's going to go through all your computer hardware settings. So basically your graphics card and your CPU, and it's going to tell you what is the top tier quality that it can do for you. Now, this isn't to say that you can't export out like 4K or 8K 360 degree view videos. This just means this is what it's really capable of doing, not necessarily what you can export. So it's just a good idea to do that just in case you're going to be very limited on your hardware. Right off the bat, there's a couple of things you can do. So you can hook up your camera directly to this InstaPro Stitcher interface. So you can import it through the SD card hub. So you'll have seven SD cards into the SD card hub. You can do it that way. That way I find is really, really time consuming. It's best to use the hub and just drag everything over manually. I found if you go through the hub, it creates just a whole lot of, it's just a mess. Also, the second method through the PC LAN cable from the camera, it's not necessarily as big of a mess, but it's just so much easier to take the SD cards out of the ball and plug those directly into this hub and then drag them over manually. Way easier. It's a little bit more work on the back end, but you just have like a good sense of, okay, this is what we're going to do. So there's two ways of adding files directly into the Stitcher. You can go to File, Add Original Files, and you can find the original files this way. Me, personally, I like to drag over files that I have already fixed, which is, I'm going to drag a couple over right now. But basically what we've dragged over is an 8K 3D 30fps piece of footage. So whenever you have your footage dragged over like this, you're going to see a lot of things in this footage. So you're going to have LRV footage, which is basically kind of like the proxy version of each individual camera. And in the sixth origin file here from the LRV, that's where your sound is going to be. So this is where your sound is going to be on the original six. But you really don't have to worry about the LRV files. That's really kind of there just in case you need a proxy workflow. Me, I always hit my origin six or origin six through one, depending on where I want to have a starting point. So what do I look for whenever I do a 360 video? So the things I really look for are basically the best looking camera view. So I'll kind of go around the camera and I'll see where I want to be viewing. So let's say I want to be viewing that. There's not a whole lot of crazy stuff in the way. There's nothing in the camera space here. It's looking right directly at the sun, which is fortunately behind a cloud, so you're not getting a really bad view. So I'm going to go ahead and select my origin 3 file here. I'm going to go ahead and hit pause just so we're not playing that back constantly. So over here on the right, you're going to see your stitching panel. So we've got your stitcher here. We have the content type. Now, going into virtual reality, this part is really the most crucial part. This is where you're going to figure out what your end game is. So where it says content type, you need to know how your viewer is going to be viewing this, or how you want your viewer to be viewing this. Monoscopic means that it's going to create, all six of these cameras is going to create one big ball. So it's going to create a mono view. So whenever you view it in VR, you're only going to be seeing it out of one eye. So both eyes will be seeing one piece of video, which is going to be the same video. Stereoscopic, left eye on top, is going to be, you're going to be looking at each camera separately. So you're going to be looking at two cameras simultaneously. So it'll be putting one piece of footage on top and another piece of footage on the bottom, allowing the video player to separate both video feeds into left and right eye. So that way you can see it in stereo. So whenever they talk about 8K stereoscopic video, really what you're looking at is two 4K pieces of footage for left and right video. And then you have these VR proximity modes. Now, I wouldn't really necessarily worry about these unless you have a piece of footage that you are wanting to cut out maybe the back end of. So like, say if you're looking over a cliff or there's something in the background that you don't want people necessarily to see, maybe you've got a crew with you or anything like that, you can set up the VR proximity mode and then you can set the gaze accordingly. So I'm going to go ahead and select my stereo left eye on top. Now we've got the stitching mode. They have a couple of different modes here. We've got scene specific templates. These are like close up, further away type scenes, and they have optical flow. So basically what optical flow does is it looks at the scene and it goes through all the different pixels. So if it says there's something moving, it tries to compensate for all of the different where the camera has to stitch. So anytime it sees a line, it tries to compensate where it goes over that line. So anything that moves or flows over that line, it compensates for that. So it tries to make it look as natural as possible. The new optical flow mode is actually very, very good. So try to always select that. Under sampling type, this is where you're going to see the most benefit. If you have the Insta360 Pro 2, I found it is best to stay at about medium for the workflow. A 2-minute clip usually takes about an hour to render, and I'm rendering on a 1080. So I try to stay in the medium zone. It takes about an hour per clip, and then that's around 2 minutes for an 8K stereoscopic clip. Now, if you go slower than that, it takes anywhere from 2 to 4 hours. And if you're looking for time consuming, that's where you're gonna spend your most time, is just sitting there and waiting for those to render out. So I try to stick around in the medium zone. You're not gonna see a whole lot of quality loss if you stick it to the slow mode. So if you stick it at medium and you wanna go to slow, you can check out the different qualities, but my personal opinion, medium is around the best just for time consumption as well as quality. Under blender type, we have a bunch of different things. Now this all depends on your computer. If you don't have a computer that has a GPU, you obviously want to do CPU. If you have AMD graphics card, you want to use OpenCL. If you have NVIDIA, you're going to use CUDA. I try to stick to auto, but I know my computer is CUDA core operated. So I'm just going to go ahead and set it there just in case it wants to use my AMD processor. Now, where it says optical flow stitching range, that's how many pixels it looks at to try to stick on to offset the stitcher. So you can mess with this a little bit depending on your scene. If there's a lot of movement, you may want to move this up a bit. If there's not, the standard settings are just fine. I wouldn't really mess with those too much unless there's a lot of movement. Same with the template stitching range. That is the same. The template stitching range is just the right on the seam where it stitches. And you can see that by messing with those settings. Right now, I'm not going to mess with those because my footage right here is just, we're just getting up on a base point to get you guys started. I'm not going to go through these settings right now. What we're just doing is we're getting a base point of working in VR. This is a landscape piece of footage, so I'm not going to mess with those too much. Right here on these check boxes, it says use original offset. So this is the offset that is made by the camera. That is fine. Usually whenever you don't have to necessarily set your offset in the camera, the default is really good, so I don't usually worry about that. Smooth stitch, that goes off these settings here. Yes, you want smooth stitch. That's going to do anything that is moving in the foreground, it's going to have that smoothing stitched. Flow state stabilization. Now, whenever you have this on a monopod and you're moving and you're recording at the same time, you will want flow state stabilization on. Now, this is a landscape piece of footage, so I do not have that on simply for the fact that it's not moving. So if your camera is moving, try to always, always, always put flow state stabilization on. If you don't, your viewer is going to get sick. I call it the sea legs effect, because if something is moving and you're not moving, you're going to feel sick. It's just going to give you a little bit of that off kind of feel. And then use hardware decoding. Have that on. That's just going to use your CPU and your GPU to help decode all of this footage. Now, software encoding speed. Yes, of course, everybody wants the fastest decode or encoding speed, but that is going to lower your megabytes per second, which is going to affect how good this footage looks. Me, I find medium to high quality is going to be the best. Again, that really all depends on what your computer is able to do and how long you have to work on the footage. The higher settings you go, the longer it's going to take. Again, a 2-minute clip comes in around 30 minutes to an hour to 2 hours. So the higher this goes, the longer you're going to wait. So I'm going to go ahead and set mine on medium. And that is really it for setting up the footage to get it into the set and preview mode. So before we go into set and preview, what you're going to want to do is you're going to want to find a reference frame. So the reference frame is basically just going to be right through here. It's going to be the frame that looks the best. This looks good. I mean, this is just landscape footage, but what you're going to want to do is set the gaze to something that looks almost that goes across the seam, and you want to try to set it from there. So if there's something that goes across the seam, usually this is the best part of this video right here. If something is going across this side or this side, you want to try to set it towards there and then set and preview that, and then you can set your stitching. So we're going to go ahead and set and preview. So here we are in the set and preview section of the Insta360 Pro Stitcher. Again, we have the same optical flow settings. This is really where you're going to dial in these settings where it goes across the stitching points. So this, all of a sudden, this right here looks good. So this is a perfectly stitched piece of footage once we get it in here. And that's what we're setting off of this reference frame that we set. So it automatically stitches based upon that reference frame. Before we go further, let's talk about what we've got on the left. So what we're going to talk about is over here in the stitching effect. So we've got the optical flow stitching range, and then we also have these logo settings. Now this is where we need to figure out whether or not we want to take care of this tripod and the shadow or not. So there's a couple different ways of doing that. There is the more advanced way, which would be cloning all of this out in like Mocha AE or Photoshop or another editing suite. But the easiest way is just to use the Nadir logo. Now this is a PNG logo. You can use a JPEG, anything that you have, and it can cover this up right down here on the bottom. So my logo is just a PNG image right here. I'm not going to use it, but this is just going to be for tutorial purposes, just so you can see what it does. What it does is uses the equirectangular format to stretch your logo over the bottom portion of the video. So in order to see that, we have these settings down here. So we can click on this little viewport icon right here and go to natural view. And that puts us into the view of what our viewers are going to be looking at. Now this automatically looks at the left eye. So you're not going to be able to see both left and right eye until you use the crystal viewer, which is in the stitcher in the previous window. But we're not going to focus on that right now. So if you look down, you can see the logo has appeared. It is right there. It would be covering up our tripod, but this is just my logo. Whatever. So there we have also some other settings. We've got flat, that way you can see it backed so you can be using it a little bit better. We've got the crystal ball setting. So if you wanted to look at it in several different ways, you can. Also got Tiny Planet. This is my favorite just because I love this little Tiny Planet thing. It's fun to look at. The sky is a planet. No, you are a planet. It's fun to look at. And then backing into our default viewport. You can also zoom in and zoom out. So even in the natural view, you can zoom in and zoom out. So you can change the field of view whenever you want to. So normal field of view, you're probably looking at about right there, which is about a 50 millimeter camera lens. Let's go ahead and turn off our Nadir logo. The next thing we're gonna focus on is, say that it does crop out your tripod, but it looks just a little squirrely. Now, if you look around here, we've got some weird little lines going on here, and more than likely up at the top, if we had some sky here or some clouds going over, it would be doing the same thing. To take care of that, you can use what's called Zenith Optimization. We'll go ahead and click that. And that just kind of brings things back to somewhat normal. So now it kind of looks a little bit better, good enough for what we're doing right now. The next thing we'll go over is you've got color adjustments. So you have one preset, which is the default preset, just in case you need to completely change this. But this isn't necessarily the most powerful color correction software in the entire world. You can change the brightness, change the contrast, kind of bring in some more color, move shadows down, move them up. Very basic, rudimentary kind of things. Me personally, whenever I use the Insta360 Pro 2, whenever I'm doing this, I like to have the temperature up a little bit because the sensor reads blue really, really well. So just adding just a little bit of yellow or orange to our footage with the temperature gauge here, with a temperature slider, gives it a little bit more of a realer effect. And sometimes just adding just a little bit of tint of the magenta side will bring that white balance up and make it just look a little bit better. One of the things about the Insta360 Pro is you want it to come over sharply. So whenever you put it into an Oculus, it's going to be somewhat sharp. So I'm going to go ahead and push up the sharpness a little bit. And that's looking pretty good. There's me. Yeah, that's looking pretty good. And I'm going to go ahead and set this as my reference frame. So this is looking good. And I'm going to hit save and apply. All right, so the last thing that we're going to check out is going to be our output settings. This is everything we're going to need to output this a certain way. Now, whenever I think about VR, I try to think about all the end users, everyone who is going to be viewing this. So I set up what's called a hierarchy system, which is going to be 8K, the highest format that this can possibly jet out. Output as .move. This is probably one of the most important things you're going to want to focus on is the codec type. So if you are going to need to be doing any sort of mocha tracking, if you're going to be needing to use any type of color correction post, if you're going to be really wanting to dive into any type of compositional work after this process, you need to set this up to ProRes 422 HQ. The reason why that is because if you were to use this as H.264 footage or H.265 footage, it's not as lossless as it should be. It still will be able to work, but it is rough. So basically, the ProRes version of this footage is going to be a lot cleaner to use in any type of editing suite. So if you know you're going to be needing to do some tripod tracking and taking that out in Mocha, if you're going to be using any type of software to work on this file after this step, please use .move. It's just going to be easier. There's going to be so much less headache. One thing about it is it will take a little bit longer to render out just because it's a higher setting. But trust me, it is going to be so much easier in the long run to just go ahead and do this right now than to worry about it later. So since I'm not going to be needing to worry about that, I'm going to go ahead and put this as H.264. That means that this is ready to go onto the web. So the profile setting is basically just for the H.264 codec. It doesn't really have to do with the .move. This just basically says how good do you want your footage to look. It's just another one of those decoding type of situations. Me, main is fine. It'll look just fine. Bitrate 480 megabytes per second is more than enough. I think that will be just fine for our project. If you need it to go up higher than that, you can. Again, the higher this number, the longer it's going to take to export. And for the audio type, we've got several different things. You've got normal, none, and spatial. So I just set it to spatial just because the ball itself has microphones on it. They're not very good. So if it's a windy day, you're going to get some trash audio. But it's there. You might as well have it. So you can export that as a wave by itself, or you can just uncheck that and it will render out into the video. And then the next part is our output directory. You can set that to anything you want, and also the output file to anything that you like. So I'm going to go ahead and set mine. And then after that, that is really all there is to getting this Stitcher up and running for as a base point. There is way more to this Stitcher than just this. There is going into the crystal viewer. There is going up into some more hardware settings that we can set up. But right now, this is going to be kind of the optimal settings for the Insta360 Pro Stitcher. So everyone, thank you for watching this tutorial on the Insta360 Pro Stitcher. My name is Cherokee. Please like and subscribe to my videos. Also, make sure to hit that notification bell. I would really appreciate it if you enjoyed this. Please subscribe. All right, everyone, thank you for watching, and I will see you next time.